councillors, ladies and gentlemen from the public and the media, thank you very much for being here with us tonight. It's 7:30, we're here. So first item on the agenda of tonight's cabinet, any apologies for absence? Don't have any, please. Beg your pardon? May I suggest you sit closer, I can't turn the volume up on this. How's that, sir? Thank you. Declarations of interest. Councillor Zirgin.
I've got a non-pecuniary interest in the matter of the award of the contract for HTS as a non-executive director.
You're not pecuniary.
No, I have a pecuniary interest because it's money.
I will get it right on time.
You're not lucky.
You wish, Simon.
Gentlemen, please. I'd just like to make a slight amendment to the running order of the agenda tonight. I'd like to propose item 16 move up to just after item 7, petitions from the public, just as the item 16 pertains to an item that a number of members of the public have asked a question about, and they may wish to sit and hear that section of tonight's cabinet debate. Cabinet consent for us to do that? Okay, item 3 minutes, pages 4 to 10 of the pack. Councillors, are you content for me to approve those?
Approve.
Are there any matters arising from those minutes? No? Okay. Then we move on to item 5, written questions from the public. There are a number here. We have question 1 from Mr. Cliff Phillips to Councillor Simon Carter. Mr. Phillips, would you like to come up to the microphone to ask your question?
Now, I understand and appreciate that the major works can be a
financial burden to the leaseholders, and we have provided already quite a lot of information to the to individuals calling us beforehand. I and my housing colleagues will continue to respond to any further questions you may have with information and support in addition to the further consultation that will occur after the awarding of the contract. The council, as landlord of the block, is responsible for keeping the maintenance to an acceptable standard with an obligation to ensure the structure and fabric are kept in good order. The works specifically blocks have been identified as required in order to meet these obligations to ensure its building components remain safe and serviceable. The project also improves the energy efficiency and reduces ongoing maintenance costs. It is, however, understood by their very nature that these works can be disruptive. Every effort has therefore been made to minimise disruption by packing these works together. Evidence suggests this approach is more cost effective, lowering the potential cost of these orders, such as only one use of scaffolding, for example, as outlined in our lease. Consultation for those leaseholders within the block has and is being undertaken through the formal processes. Leaseholders are invited at various stages of the consultation process to express their views in an environment of openness and transparency to ensure works are fair and reasonable. I note the question regarding a potential sinking fund for these works. Approximately 20 years ago, all leaseholders were written to with the option of establishing a sinking fund as part of their service charge or to pay for major works as and when required. Responsible leaseholders were to pay major works invoices as and when required. The contract award tonight outlines the procurement process the council has undertaken and its approach. For example, a minimum of two contractors are required to provide estimates for their works aligned to the legal requirements. Seven companies were invited to tender as described in tonight's report in paragraph four. All tenders are appropriately evaluated, carrying out intensive checks to ensure that tenders meet the council's requirements, which include quality and insurances, as well as financial and economic standing. You'll note from the contract award tonight, both quality and price are evaluated separately to ensure a balanced award of any contract, with quality evaluated first. It is usual practice for leaseholders to be informed of the winning contractor and also to receive a breakdown of the work specification and background information, including surveys. This is the next stage of the consultation process, and the information will be sent out in the post. A meeting will also be arranged for leaseholders to review and inspect the tender documents and associated information. In addition, it is also usual practice for evening meetings to be arranged with council officers and relevant contractors who will be doing the work. Leaseholders will have the right to challenge either the cost, including any fees, or scope of the work for the formal challenge that can be done at any time during the major works process using the first tier tribunal property chamber. Unfortunately, there are no grants or government funding for these works, which are paid for from the council's ring-fenced housing revenue account. However, the council continues to make representations to help support the costs associated with increasing building safety, and in particular fire safety. Being acutely aware of the cost, the council have a number of payment options to help leaseholders spread the cost, including from 2.5% prompt payment discount, 10 months interest-free payments, an interest-free loan over a term of up to 5 years secured against the property, a council loan secured against the property, a discretionary loan secured against the property, a voluntary charge, and a flexible payment option. The investor landlords may only apply to options 1, 4, and 6. Individual leaseholders are encouraged to contact their housing officer to discuss the best way forward for them. The council considers these works to be transformative making the outside of your home sort of more attractive and the inside safer and more thermally efficient, with ongoing savings to maintenance costs.
Thank you, Councillor Carter. Mr Phillips, do you have a supplementary question? Now you may ask a supplementary question before you move on to your second question.
We want to know why it's such a high price compared with other quotes on a similar building. Because that's what it's all about, is the money.
Thank you. Not the
fact, yeah, we know that there's got to be work done on those properties. Some of it's not been maintained for years. So obviously something's got to be done. But why so much?
Mr. Phillips, again, thank you for your supplementary. Could you turn your microphone off so we can avoid the feedback? Thank you. Councillor Carter.
Thank you. I think you sort of touched on one of the problems that we've had over the last 5 or 6 years. We have been, we in the council, the Housing Revenue Account has been short of funds to invest in repairs and maintenance work. We had 4 years when rents were actually reduced by 1% a year, which had a huge impact on the income of the Housing Revenue Account, and then we've had some COVID in the last 2 years, that's what slowed everything down. So yes, maintenance has fallen back, but I'd say what we're trying to do is to squeeze as much work as possible into the repairs and maintenance package to make it as cost efficient as possible. But as I say, you know, there are a number of ways that the individual leaseholders or occupiers should speak to their housing officer to actually discuss what is the best way forward for them. But in addition to all that, as I said before, there will be a further series of meetings once the contract has been awarded, where the actual terms and conditions and content of the prices of the contract will be reviewed and discussed. And it is possible to make some changes to that.
Thank you, Councillor. Mr. Phillips, you have a second question for Councillor Carter.
From what information I've been able to gather, the major works on Rundles, the Hides and the Hornbeams completed in the last few years was a similar extent to the proposed works. Tenders of larger variations were submitted by companies that have not been invited to quote for the work on the 5 acres. The estimated cost to these individual leaseholders was up to a third of the current estimated works on the 5 acres. Therefore, would I ask for the tenders to be resubmitted to ensure competitive and reputable companies?
Thank you, Mr. Phillips. As Councillor Carter has already indicated, the answer to that question has been taken en masse, but you do have the right to a supplementary question if you wish to ask him one.
I think it covers it.
Thank you very much for your time, Mr. Phillips. We now have a question from Mr. Jackman to Councillor Carter. Sorry, Janet and Keith Jackman, beg your pardon.
How can you pick a tender for 5 acres works this evening when there are so many unhappy leaseholders who have sent their concerns to the relevant officer about the tenders for the works? It is not acceptable to have only 2 tenders to choose from. I do not feel confident that we have been given a fair price due to only 2 tenders, and then we're worried that they don't have past good reviews. We are very concerned by Harlow Council with the land works of these to go ahead with only two formal tenders receives, as it does not make sense or good business practice. Additionally, we have noticed that you are using different contractors for sites all the time.
Thank you, Mrs. Jackman. And as has previously been said, your answer to the question has been formally given to you on page 3 of the pack. So, do you have a supplementary question for Councillor Carter?
Yes. When you say that the buildings are maintained, I have a property in Hornbeams and I had to pay major works there, and the building was really run down. I did go to tribunal for historic works, but when I got on there, they talked about something else. But surely if the council are not looking after their buildings and they're deteriorating, then we are having to pay more. He said, this gentleman here said, that they're not doing the buildings and we haven't had the funds. But because you haven't had the funds, it means buildings are not being maintained. And it says in the contracts that you maintain them, but you haven't.
Mrs. Chapman, may I ask you to pull all of your comments together as a question? I understand the strength of feeling and what you're saying, but could you please ask a question?
What about this? Well,
we understand the strength of feeling, but what is your question to the councillor?
The councillor?
Yes.
We're not happy about two tenders. We're not happy with the price. We're not happy with the refuse. And we're just not happy with the price, basically. And also, not happy with, how they charge for the primaries and things. They got to have huts and phone lines. And
Mrs. Chapman, may I assist you tonight? Is your question, you're not happy with the price, so is there an alternative mechanism to set another price?
I've just said is, you've only got two tenders. We are not happy. All of the 5 acres leaseholders are not happy with two tenders. I feel that the price difference, I feel there could be something underhand with it. I don't feel confident that this has been put through properly.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Chapman. So, Councillor Carter, I believe the question is, can there be more tenders than the two that have been currently put?
I did refer in my main answer that 7 separate companies were invited to tender. It is quite a large complex tender. We only received 3 responses, and one of those was actually non-compliant. So we were left with the 2. A lot of companies have been provided the opportunity to tender. And for reasons best known to themselves, they have done that. We can't force people to do it. The people we invite to tender we carry out due diligence on them. So we know they are competent to do it from their previous work. We know they are financially stable enough to actually do the work. And so we are aware. Once the contract has been awarded, there will be further consultation with the leaseholders to actually go through the detail of the tender, and that will be an opportunity for you to put forward the tender.
Thank you, Councillor. Mrs. Jackman, I'm asking you to move on to question 4 that you put in the pack.
I think with what's going on in the world with COVID, war, bills, etc., that major work should come to a stop at the moment. It's not fair on people. Can the works not be done over a long period so we haven't got 30,000 bills to pay at once? If the council maintained their buildings, we wouldn't have such a high bill. Maybe then the cost of primaries would not be so costly and bring our bill down. Maybe they would not need huts and phone lines, etc. These contractors go to work like any other company and workers do. Will this be considered by Harlow Council? It's ruining people's lives and the councils don't care as they can just use taxpayers' money for their tenants. We feel that we are being ripped off by these contractors and something needs to be done to protect us leaseholders. The government needs to step in because this is happening in all councils across the country and we will not stop fighting as a group.
Thank you, Mrs. Chapman. Do you have a supplementary question to that?
Yes, I mean, on that one, it says about the maintaining of the buildings. Also, with the primaries for this project is £100,000 before we even put a liquor paint on. I had furniture works done in all things, and we paid 60-something thousand for primaries, and all we had was a hut, because they used the hide, and it seemed that all they used this hut for was for the site manager to sleep in, which my husband found in. My thing is why if the breweries weren't so high, then our buildings wouldn't be so high. Why cannot the work be done with just contractors coming to work and doing their job? Why do they need site huts, secure yards and things? I mean, you're saying that you're using companies that are like the health and safety. We had Zerkin do beans. I've got pictures here and I will send them to you. The health and safety is absolutely ridiculous.
Mrs. Chapman, I managed to get, I think the main stem of your question was why are we using, why the cost of the primary zone?
Yeah.
I understand you're very passionate about this.
I'm very passionate because this is our second major works.
I appreciate that. So everyone can hear you and understand you, can I ask you to stand as you are now from the microphone? Because when you get very close, it guards you so we can't hear what you're saying.
Yeah.
So I understand you want to know why the cost of the preliminary is the same.
Well, why can't you just you have to have companies come and have these, it's 100,000 for this.
Mrs. Jackman, we've heard your question and Councillor Carter will give you the answer.
Thank you. Referring to my previous answer, which I think was fairly comprehensive, there will be, once the contract has been awarded, there will be a series of meetings with the leaseholders to actually go through the terms and contents of the contract itself, where details like this can actually be explored and talked through. We don't have that level of detail.
No, they've got their primaries, and that's it. And it's an open checkbook, the primaries. The council have no say. The company has the open checkbook.
Thank you very much.
I think it's ridiculous.
Thank you very much indeed for your questions. Okay. Thank you, Councillor Harvey. Moving on to question five from Mr. Williams to Councillor Carter. Beg your pardon, Mr. Williams. Would you like to go ahead with reading your question out?
My question is, I am really concerned because my job isn't safe and I don't have any money to pay for this. How can you expect us to pay for this for all of a sudden? If I knew about the potential of high costs years in advance, then I could have at least tried to save something. I feel completely let down by Harrow Council. Could there be more done to try and receive further tenders from contractors to try and reduce the cost?
And again, the answer to your question has already been covered by the councillor, so you have the opportunity to ask him a supplementary question. Do you have a further question you'd like to ask him?
I just, how can, you know, I'm just worried about my job. I'm not sure, maybe in a few years or 5 years time, maybe a few months later, my safety job is not safe, and how I'm supposed to pay it. And I already got loan, Tesco loan. I borrowed money of my family. I got 5,000 pound credit card. And you expect me to pay.
Thank you, Mrs. Williams. You've asked your question. I want the councillor to answer you now.
Thank you, Chair. Referring to my original reply and the subsequent questions, there are a range of options open to leaseholders to sort of spread the cost over a variety of areas in a variety of ways. We've also explained that, yes, we have got that line with repairs and maintenance, so some of these costs should have come along a bit earlier. So you would be facing those bills by now. I say what we're trying to do now is to get as much work together as possible to reduce the actual overall price to make it better. But again, as I've said, there will be a subsequent meeting with the contractor to go through the terms, and just to speak to your housing officer to discuss your actual
We now have a question from Sally Jones to Councillor Carter.
Thank you. I'd like to ask, where are the condition surveys for the roof? Where are the condition surveys for the windows? And where are the condition surveys for the cladding? Because I haven't seen them yet.
Thank you very much. And do you have a supplementary question?
Know where the condition surveys are, because I do not see how this work can be predicted without those.
Okay, so Councillor Carter, I think maybe you could focus your answer around that particular one.
Okay. As Alan mentioned already, there will be a series of meetings, not just one, but a series of meetings with the leaseholders once the contract has been awarded. One will be specifically to examine the actual tender document and the supporting information as well, which will include things like the surveys and so forth. That'll be one meeting, and then there'll be another meeting with contractors to actually go through you know, the contents of the contract and how the work is. So the information will be made available to you. There's no problem at all about that. It's just it hasn't been done at the moment.
Thank you. Mrs. Jones, you have another question for the councillor.
Yes, from one of my neighbours. As we understand, in according to our lease, they will build up a service charge in our separate fund to gain interest over time. We would like to know if this has been done or it can contribute towards any major works. If not, then when the service charge will be used for. I understand you said about the sinking fund was rejected previously. So I hear your answer to that.
Do you have a further question for the councillor?
No further question, just disappointed that this correspondence had been sent out before the condition surveys were reviewed.
All right. Now we'll move on to written questions from councillors. Question one, Councillor Vince to Councillor Joel Charles. Councillor Vince.
Thank you, Chair. It's a councillor. I'm going to ask this question to Councillor Joel Charles. I asked the question what we discussed yesterday's scheduled subcommittee meeting. But I think it's important to ask in a public forum like this. Can you give an absolute assurance that the priority of HTS is and should be property environment follow above and beyond the profit of other aspects of the new business plan?
Councillor Jones.
Thank you, Chair. I'm grateful for the opportunity to expand on my reply to you previously. One of the cornerstones of the plan is to continue to focus on the performance of the core service that HS was established to deliver. In the first year of the new business plan, for example, there are commitments to update the service level agreement, key performance indicators, and value for money benchmarking to ensure a focus remains on the core activity sitting within property and environment. The revenue target, predicted to land at over 31 million by 2026-27, reflects the ambition for property and environment within the now HTS group. My colleagues within the Cabinet are taking forward various elements of this focus on property and environment, particularly Councillor Nikki Purse, who is working closely with HTS on the ground. The new subsidiaries sitting under the group structure, two of which are subject to a feasibility study and options appraisal respectively, enable the HTS group to grow to support its future viability and pave the way to access new market opportunities to drive a commercial approach that was always envisaged as the next logical step for our local authority trading company. This is a commitment reinforced in the Council's corporate strategy, complementing the work to deliver the best possible core service.
Councillor Binns-Jones, supplementary question.
Yeah, thank you, Councillor Charles, for that answer. As I said last night, I appreciate, you know, the importance that the Outlook puts on HTS, certainly something that's very dear to us, particularly those core services. My question, and sort of, I apologize for sending this in advance, so you might be able to give us a full answer, but perhaps it would be nice, but I'll come speak about it today. And following the conversation with John Phillips, we spoke about kind of a risk analysis and risk matrix. And I just wondered, moving forward, if you've got any idea of, you know, the timescale of putting together the implementation plan for the new businesses, and obviously when we might be able to think about that risk assessment.
Thank you, Councillor Williams, for that question. On page 22 of the business plan, you'll see the year one objectives and outcomes. As a result of that work, one of those elements is to agree the value for money criteria and measures that will complement that. It is envisaged in the first year under this timeline that the risk ratings will be applied to those entities that go forward. We are obviously doing some due diligence around two of the particular propositions, sitting one within housing and regeneration and two the construction subsidiary. And as part of that work will be the risk rating that will be applied to those as part of the wider visibility and options appraisal. So the guarantee I can give you is that within the first year of this roadmap set out in the business plan, we will be doing that appropriate risk rating.
Councillor Durbin, I think you have a question for me.
I'm happy to have it read, and I'm quite happy to answer the supplementary, if that's okay with you.
I'd like to read the answer because we've got many more people.
Okay, well, I'll read the question then.
Yes.
Sorry, I was trying to reduce time. As you're aware, following the evidence provided at the Hertfordshire County Council Health Scrutiny Committee, it's now clear that there is no current agreed funding for the design and development of the new Princess Alexandra Hospital. Can you explain your understanding of the situation? Whilst the Member of Parliament and your own Cabinet members have indicated that funding had been agreed, could we ask you to facilitate an urgent meeting to understand what is fact and what is fiction, with key partners, including political leadership from each of the parties? Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Durbin, for your question. So we've received no correspondence from the Department of Health to contradict the government's recent detailed announcement about Harlow's new hospital as part of their levelling up white paper. The announcement stated that a new integrated high-tech healthcare campus will replace the aging Princess Alexandra Hospital. As such, we continue to be one of the 8 Pathfinder hospitals as part of the National New Hospital Programme, abbreviated to NHP. The NHP is working to secure a clear funding assessment from Her Majesty's Treasury through a complete new hospital programme business case that supports the 48 new hospital schemes planned for 2030. Our understanding is that the NHP is making the case for an increased level of investment sufficient to enable preferred options to be delivered across all Pathfinder schemes and all other schemes. This is aligned with a review by the NHP of the minimum standards required for example, including the percentage of single rooms and the amount of digital investment required. Detailed costs for the outlined business case cannot be finalised until final guidance on minimum standards has been received. It's clear that the cost of delivering a new integrated high-tech healthcare campus on a greenfield site, including digital investment and investment in net zero carbon technology, significantly exceeds the original indicative allocations announced in 2019, that being £350 million. We understand that the NHP programme business case will be presented to HM Treasury at the end of the spring.
Thank you for reading that. My supplementary is, I was wondering whether or not you could actually respond to the question with, would you agree that it would be helpful to facilitate an urgent meeting to understand what is fact and what is fiction with key partners, including the political leadership from each party? That was the original question, which you have failed to answer. Do you need advice?
Councillor Durkin, when we know more, we will be happy to facilitate a meeting. But currently, I'm giving you the latest understanding, and we've been in consultation with our colleagues at the West Essex Healthcare Trust to understand this situation more, and I've given you as much information as available to me. So I'm more than happy to arrange meetings in the future when more information comes to light.
Thank you.
Question three, Councillor David Carter to Councillor Dale Stokes. Councillor Carter.
Thank you, Jim. Question again. I understand the Cabinet Member for Regeneration has announced a new house building programme that we will see tonight. I want to know whether any more money will be wasted on consultancy plans and fees that lead to nothing, and if these schemes will actually be delivered and not just left on the shelf as they have been in the past.
Thank you for your question. The new council building programme we're setting out tonight will not only deliver hundreds of new council homes for holiday families, but it radically overhauls the way the council goes through the process of house building. As set out in the report, a new three-stage process to ensure value for money is at the forefront of every decision. At all three stages, both myself and the Director of Strategic Growth and Regeneration must sign a formal report setting out in-depth detail of the scheme and its ambitions. This comes on top of a dedicated section in the report about value for money. This follows an internal review when it came to light that £1.13 million had been spent by a former Cabinet Member for Regeneration on house building projects that never happened. The new house building programme also focuses on delivery. The 2021 scrutiny report on house building highlighted the litany of failures in the process. I will not go through those well-versed issues, but this report addresses them all. The new process will ensure that never again will 450,000 be spent on designs, plans and consultants fees only to discover a water main under the sun. It goes further and makes clear that we will be absolutely transparent and accountable at every stage. And finally, it shows that we will be on site building new council homes for Harley families within months. So no schemes will be left on the shelf. Never again will taxpayers' money be wasted. And yes, we are delivering hundreds of new council homes for Harley families.
Thank you, Councillor Swords. Councillor Carter, do you have a supplementary?
Yes, I do. I'd like to thank the council for his answer. In my ward, I have the eyesore called Sherard's House. It's been a problem for many years. In the plans you say it will be used to build 16 new homes, and these will be completed by June 2024. What I'd like to know is what type of these homes will be and when will construction start?
As the new build programme sets out, these will be mixed dwellings in terms of size, and I can assure you of the highest quality, because I don't think you'd let me get away with anything less. And as I understand, we'll be on site under construction within the next 12 months.
Thank you. Councillor Carter, I believe you have another question for Councillor Source.
Yes, Chairman, thank you. For many years, people have promised to do something about the town centre. I see that the new three-part plan has been announced. But when will we see action? Not just more plans, but actual construction work.
Councillor Source.
Our new three-step plan to regenerate the town centre is a crystal clear roadmap to the future we want to see. Future in which Harlow is one of the best towns to shop, eat, drink, entertain, and enjoy leisure. Tonight we will be passing the first step in that roadmap, the first ever planning framework for the town centre. This cannot be understated. It arms our planning department with the powers they did not previously have to safeguard our town centre as the liberation that has been so long overdue, namely proper regeneration, steps forward. As the three steps set out, there will be no more dither and delay. We are getting on with the job of regenerating our town centre, and construction work will be underway in parts of the town centre within the next financial year. This will be followed by much greater construction work as set out in the three-step plan. Also want to address one final point. I've read back through nearly 14 years worth of press reports about the town centre, as you would expect me to do, dating back to when the Stockman scheme did not progress. And the thing that struck me more than anything was the absolute comfort in underperformance. The excuses that we can't do anything, it's all down to the private sector and the government won't give us the money. I say to those people, you should be ashamed. You have held Harlow back and let down our town. We are getting on with the job and rebuilding our town centre.
Councillor Carter, did you have a supplementary question?
Just a quick question. Are we watching the progress?
More a statement of intent, I imagine. No, okay.
Probably won't be any longer.
Right, so let's bring some questions from councillors. Petitions from the public have not been made aware of any. Yes, I'm going on to that next. No petition? Okay. And as I said earlier, I'm moving item 16 up, which is the contract award for external refurbishment 106 to 116. 38 to 42, 45 to 49, 7 to 17, and 85 to 95, 5 acres, found on page 442 to 444 of your pack. I'll allow councillors time to find that page, and when we get there, I'll ask Councillor Simon Carter to move that paper. Councillor Carter, do you move that paper?
Is that moved, actually?
Can I take a second for that? Yes. Over to you, Councillor Carter.
Thank you, Chair. I want to submit this one. I think it's been deputy aired tonight. There is a lot of work being done to the five acres. That's what I had to say. We have got behind with the repairs and maintenance. But we believe by bringing all these things together, we can actually reduce the overall cost. Now, it is a big hit, there are several options available to leaseholders to try and help them pay. There is more consultation to carry on with the landlord once the contract was awarded. Contacted the housing officer to discuss their individual circumstances and see where else we can go. The next round of consultation with the contractor, they will be going through the details, and if there's, there's anything that can be done better or differently, then that will be considered. Although obviously I'm not making any guarantees at this stage.
Thank you, Councillor Carter. We come to questions and answer events.
I note that according to the papers that this is in the Harlow Common. Is that correct?
I believe not.
Can I ask the papers be correct, please? First question.
Of course, I do apologise.
Thank you. Secondly, picking up on the points I think you've made in terms of the debate, can I ask how the criteria for the repayment options was arrived at? So you list the number of 1 to 7 ways in which payment can be made. Can I ask how does that criteria arrive?
These options are an existing set which have been developed over many years to help out with moving payments. I think item seven is probably a more flexible one, and you know, they are encouraged to talk to their housing to discuss that personal circumstances and how the council can actually help them.
Councillor,
if I may come back again, can I ask then that given that where we are currently at a time of huge economic potential hardship, people are facing huge potential hardship, can I ask that consideration be given also to reviewing that? I don't know when that was last reviewed, that criteria. Can I ask that consideration be given to reviewing the criteria to bear in mind, let's say, the current situation, economic situation that tenants now find, sorry, leaseholders now find themselves in?
Thank you, Councillor Hayes. Councillor Carter.
Thank you, Chair. So there is a range of options and flexibility there already, but obviously everything which can be looked at will be looked at. And yes, I can give you that undertaking that we will be going through that.
Councillor Edwards, you have a question?
Another question. Again, picking up from the discussion earlier on there, what seemed to be concerning the leaseholders was that the contract was being agreed prior to them having any say in terms of what was in the contract and what the justification was for the particular bits of work that was being done. The response that was being given was, oh, you'll have that opportunity to discuss that with us and with the contractor once the contract has been agreed. Now, from the leaseholder's point of view, what they're concerned about is that the contract is being agreed, the price is being set, and they have questions about what's being agreed and why. So is it possible, prior to the contract actually being agreed, that actually further work could be done with the leaseholders looking at the justifications for the particular work that is being requested?
Councillor Carter.
Thank you. I think there have been at least 2 rounds of consultation beforehand. Advising the leaseholders that this work is coming up, what the work is going to be, including whether they wanted to nominate any particular contractors. There was no response to those 2 letters of consultations. And it's really only since the estimated bills have gone out that we've actually heard back from them. As I said during the question, there will be several more rounds of consultation, one of which is the access to all the documentation, tender documents, various surveys and so forth, they will be open. And then a meeting with contractors and housing staff to go through. In the best open and flexible way, where these details can be looked at and examined, if there are sufficient grounds, adequate grounds, sufficient meaning to change some aspect of it, then I'm sure it can be changed, which may include possibly leaving something out, possibly doing something in a different way. It's a chicken and egg. Where do you let the contract, and where do you actually analyse what's going into it? If you do it beforehand, you've no idea how much it's going to cost and how much you're talking about. So at least there is a reference point to work from. And say, does it have to be done this way? It's an alternative. You can actually see what the impact is. But say that there are
lots more rounds of consultation and lots more opportunities for the incumbents and doctors to take it forward.
Thank you.
Councillor Wilkinson.
Thank you, Chair. I have given Councillor Carter notice of my question, and I received the questions from the public today, able to see probably my question has already been asked by one of the members of the public. But just to confirm my question, and I asked Councillor Carter about what support can be given in these hard times for leaseholders. Can Councillor Carter confirm that in his answer he said there is no current government support or funding available to help his leaseholders out?
Councillor Carter.
Thank you. For the nature of the work, no, there isn't. The HRA rules and the government expect most of the routine, you know, roof repairs, walls, windows, and so forth, to be met out of the revenue account on an ongoing basis. I'll put my hand up, both on your behalf and my behalf, that we did get behind with the maintenance. Remember the problem over the falling rents for 4 years, so yes, you know, there is a problem there. But in terms of the routine maintenance, no, there isn't. There was supposed to be money coming for fire prevention works, but these problems are not tall enough to warrant that.
Councillor Robinson,
do you have any more?
I have no further questions. If I do have comments, more comments or comments, please, Chair.
That's fine. Councillor Harvey.
Thank you, Chair. Councillor Khan, you said that. Sorry, am I getting feedback from the train?
It might be your computer, but it's indeed.
Councillor Carter, I noticed you said that there hadn't been response from leaseholders on two opportunities to consult on the issue, and it wasn't until the point in which a bill or documentation about the costs were sent round that you started to hear from people, and I have sympathy to the frustration of that. Nothing sharpens the mind like seeing figures on a page. In the sense that I'm not surprised that that was when people's attention was caught by the issue, and I recognise that efforts were made before that to engage with them. But I guess my question is, would you agree that it is at least, at the best, regrettable that this issue has come to light on the day that we are looking at a community engagement strategy, which, to quote outcome two, and forgive the feedback, but I think it's important, it says, local people, or you might be saved my reading out because I've, in the interest of saving the feedback, I've shut my computer down. But outcome two.
I think we have the question though, don't we, Councillor Harvey, which is it regrettable that we've.
Well, I'd just like to say that the outcome number two is that local people feel involved in decision making that affect them. And I think it's regrettable that the process we seem to have heard about tonight does not allow for that, insofar as the points at which the future consultation is going to take place, as I have understood it from the discussion tonight, will be after the contract has been signed. Mm. And, you know, the truth of the matter is the opportunity as a community to influence the decision at that point is negligible at best. Would you agree?
Would you take it? Councillor Carter.
Thank you. Well, I agree. Probably yes. But sadly, as far as leaseholders are concerned, there is a raft of legislation, regulation, and processes where we have to observe. And you know, that is what we are observing. I'm sure it can be tweaked a bit to make sure we cover as many angles as possible. And we can certainly improve the wording and so forth. But the actual process is actually laid down in statute. And however much more we would like to. Yeah, we're always open to talk to people, obviously. But as regards process, you know, we must actually sort of follow the legislation. Otherwise, it could be a challenge.
Any further questions, Councillor Harvey?
Yes.
Okay.
table, like my follow-up question is, would you agree that there is a greater need for horizontal working within the council, so that real-life examples such as this benefit from the work that's gone into the community engagement strategy, so that that is where, because I think that is where people are really interested in seeing that kind of work find its teeth, is in issues that affect their back pocket.
Yes. Okay, I'm going to come to Councillor Charles and then you, Councillor Carter.
Thank you, Chair. I'll just get clarification from Councillor Carter. And in the letters that correspondence in terms of consultation plaintiffs questions before the correspondence about the costings, and there was an opportunity for residents to suggest a contractor in the spirit of consulting them on the process going forward.
Indeed, yes. Again, that is all part of the initial consultation process. probably not every leaseholder is fully aware of the current construction company situation. We know it, and then there might be somebody who wants to put the name forward, which they're perfectly entitled to do so. On this occasion, there's no response.
Councillor David Button.
Thank you, Chairman. What I'd like to ask is, I have a leaseholder, not in 5 acres, but another part of our home. She's had a similar sort of letters. What is concerning her is that she recently, within the last 18 months, spent £6,000 on having her windows all double glazed. The letter says that part of what's going on with the windows, now I think it would be ridiculous for her to have windows replaced, which she only had done 18 months ago. Will this further consultation rule that sort of thing out to her satisfaction?
Yes. This is why there is the follow-up meeting with the contractor, where she goes through the detail and where work is not required for whatever reason. That's not included. Obviously, she will not be charged for that element of the overall
Councillors, are there any further questions before we move into comments? Okay, anyone wishing to make comments? Councillor Wilkinson.
Thank you very much, Chair. First of all, I almost concur with Councillor Carter on one of his comments you made earlier today. I do agree with you that for years of rent reduction in this town, probably every town across this country, did significant damage to housing revenue account and did significant damage to our maintenance program because of lack of funding. So that's my start from saying we do agree on. Well, I do have a problem with this report, and probably this is going to be the first of many reports like this is going to come to this in front of this chamber with a lot of concern of leaseholders across the whole town. Well, I have a major concern and a major comment to make, and I think Councillor Carter made a comment only 2 or 3 minutes ago about there being no government funding or support for these residents because they don't live in a high enough block. What is wrong in this country is the current government have announced a little while ago that they were going to support leaseholders on fire safety works, and on page 442 of this report, it clearly indicates that there's fire safety work going on with this building work and cladding work, etc. The government have made a statement that they're willing to support leaseholders that live in blocks above a certain height. I can't understand the logic, and I waited a breath yesterday for the Chancellor's budget or spring statement, whatever it was called. I think some people called it other things, but whatever it was officially called, that maybe there'll be support offered in the hard times at the moment, and the work, I believe I saw some earlier today that the cost of living crisis is the worst for 50 years in this country. I thought there would have been support for leaseholders that having to pay for these kind of claims, fireworks within his budget. I waited with bated breath, none happened. There's no support at all for these people in that position. But if you was a leaseholder earning twice as much money, you lived in a sort of town block, then you get support and grant and funding from the government, and I find that extremely concerning. And I just wanted to make that point, I think it's incumbent across this council to put more pressure on the government to do more to help leaseholders out. They are now going to be facing major bills in this type of work. Thank you, Chair.
Any further?
So Charles seeks the opportunity to recommend a contractor to carry out major building works is what community engagement is about. I think many leaseholders would struggle to make that kind of recommendation, and yet they still would like to have a say in this process and the outcome.
In terms of support for leaseholders, across the town, yes, we have high-rise low-rise buildings, none of which contain any dubious, suspect, dangerous cladding, which is where the government's funding will be going to. In 5 acres, yes, there is external paneling, but it is inert material. I think it's probably disingenuous of Councillor Harvey to suggest that seeking nominations for construction companies is the only extent of the consultation. There is a whole raft of information and information.
So I'd like to put the recommendation A.
Sorry, Charles, can you second it
at the beginning?
Yes. Okay, sorry,
I've been good. Thank you. I will put many things, but I can always find a second at the beginning of the report. Okay. So recommendation A. Can I see those all in favour? Right, we go back to the usual running order of the agenda. Since it's been covered off. Forward work, pages 11 to 19. Councillor Durgan, any questions?
Well, yes, Chair, if I may, it's not such a long report, it's what isn't in the report. I was just wondering if I could have clarification. We are aware that HGS are extending the company to create two private companies, and I was wondering why this has been agreed behind closed doors, and why hasn't the council and councillors had the opportunity to debate that? So that's my first one. And my second one, which is my standard one, which is still not here, even though there was a clear commitment that it would be, is the announcement of the site of Acacia House. We all know what the situation is. I still don't understand why we have not published that decision that was made quite a while ago. Thank you, Chair.
Well, it's not so big, I'll answer your question tonight, Councillor Durkin. About Acacia House, we did say we would come back to you in April on that, and it's not April, it's March.
But it's not the forward plan.
And I also mentioned that we would be reworking the forward work plan to align itself with the corporate strategy, and that will be coming forth as part of the new municipal year. And the other part of your question relating to HCS and discussions and decisions being taken behind closed doors, you know yourself, you're a non-executive director of HCS. You've been fully briefed and appraised of all of the business plans, and if you haven't, I would speak to the managing director of HCS and ask you why you haven't. I would assume you've briefed all of your group as a non-executive director of HCS. If you haven't, I would suggest your group leader ask you why you haven't, because again, he should have done that.
my group has been briefed by Councillor Joel Charles, and we've had extensive meetings, and our group has been fully briefed, and I believe Councillor Charles, along with the director of HCS, came to your group meeting. I think he wasn't there, but also briefed your group and gave your group an option to go through the business plan as well, where many questions were asked. And then there was a shareholder subcommittee again, where it was all discussed and it was open to the public. And again, you could have attended that and asked questions there. So I think we've been fairly open with the process. But if you have any further ideas, please put on the postcard and I'll read them.
Sorry, can I just correct you on one thing?
Not at the moment, we can set the question when we get to it. Councillor Dan Sorts, if you wanted to come in as well.
Yeah, I'll just come back on the Acadia Council question first, which it's been asked many times, and coincidentally the answer has been the same every time. It's not in the forward plan because it's in the capital programme, and therefore wouldn't be in the forward plan because it was agreed at the budget, which obviously voted against, so I'm not sure whether you were against buying Acadia House or not. So we bought it, thank you, but you voted against the money. In terms of the sort of spurious thing you keep plastering everywhere, this decision was made last year, it wasn't, it simply fabricated and lied to suggest that it was. And the final thing I'd say is when you left administration last year, it wasn't in the full work plan. I'm sure, should an announcement be made, some credit you will want flying in your direction. However, if you didn't leave it in the full work plan, you voted against the money for it, I may politely suggest, should an announcement be made in the near future, you won't be getting any credit for it.
Do you have a supplementary question, Councillor
Dillon? Yes, on both of them, if I may, just a point of correction. My question is about democracy. If we are changing a public company into a public slash private company, surely, and listening to the people behind us and talking about engagement and consultation, surely we do have a duty and a responsibility to hold that discussion and that debate in public rather than behind closed doors. And I'm also very pleased that the cabinet member has finally confirmed, which from what I've known for 10 months, that actually Acacia House is now owned by the council. So thank you for that confirmation.
I'm sorry, I think I'll say the chief executive blushes, but nobody in the room said that, and that is incorrect of you to say that. And I suggest that you think very carefully about what you've said, and I will give you the opportunity to apologise because the chief executive is about to correct you if you don't.
Well, with respect to the chief executive, all I can do is hear what I heard. And I know that Michael is standing not too many feet, so I'm absolutely sure we can repeat the video link for what the cabinet member did say, which was that Acacia House had been bought.
No, you can't say that. And we will play that back, and I look forward to you giving an apology when that playback comes back. And on the wider point about democracy, the business plan was debated at the shelter subcommittee. It was an open public meeting, and I think every single councillor in this building has been given the opportunity to participate and to debate in that. And all of the papers related to that are in the public domain also, and I would say you can't get more democratic than that. Do you have any further questions on the forward work plan, Councillor Durkin?
No, but just to correct you.
Thank you.
Can we just confirm we haven't bought Acacia House? Is that what you're saying?
What I'm saying is...
Have we or have we not?
What I'm saying to you is, Councillor Durkin, that is not a question related to the forward work plan. I think Councillor sort has answered your question quite adequately, and he also did not say on record that we have bought Acacia House, which is what you're very much saying. So we look forward to your apology in the future. I very much doubt it will come, but I don't think I've ever heard an apology of anything you've been misquoted as saying. And I'd like to move on to the forward work plan, please. And I believe Councillor Vince was looking to ask a question about the forward work plan.
It is a question about
the
forward work plan. Page 13 to 17 of the forward work plan. There are a lot of items on this agenda tonight compared to last. And bear in mind that we had a shareholder subcommittee meeting yesterday, as you pointed out. Couldn't we have managed this a little bit better? The best part of 1,000 word pages, including some tricky documents to digest. Now, I was anticipating your answer. I recognise this is the cabinet meeting just before the elections, and you're very nervous, obviously, as administration of Labour Party is going to romp home to power in May. Serious point though, Chair, can I ask, this is looking at the future, because clearly the only 3 weeks ago we had a cabinet meeting that was quite long, and the one in June is quite light as well. And I appreciate, you know, that some reports have to come forward at a certain time, but can I just request, moving forward, we just take this into account and try and manage it a little bit better.
In answer to your question, you can always make the request to Councillor Linds. However, I have mentioned that we will be looking at the full work plan in light of the new corporate strategy, and that will be coming forward in the municipal year. But I make no apologies for having an ambitious agenda and getting a lot of business through this place. Yeah. And that's what we were expected to do, was on a mandate of an ambitious agenda for the people of this town. Do you have any further questions on the full work plan, Councillor Linds?
I have to say, would you not agree with me that actually the agenda of this size makes it quite difficult to have proper and decent scrutiny? And actually, we want to be able to scrutinise the agenda, and actually, by making this the agenda more balanced, we actually might get a better level of scrutiny from your own administration as well.
I wouldn't necessarily agree with that, because my cabinet colleagues read all of their papers and have thorough debate, as I'm sure you have thorough debate about the papers as well in your groups, and do you have access to officers in order to do that, to put forward your questions. But as I say, we have put forward a new corporate strategy, and that has been the full work plan will be looked at in the round in the new municipal year. Councillor Edwards, I believe you have a question on the full work plan.
Yeah, I have a question on the full work plan. And I trust you would agree that the whole purpose of Cabinet is to allow a degree of scrutiny in terms of the agenda and time for a degree. This was the cabinet papers for the 3rd of March. These are the cabinet papers for tonight, and the various topics that are included within it. Now, if you actually want this cabinet to work, if you actually want this cabinet to be able to be subject to a degree of scrutiny, and if you actually want to have a debate, my question is, is it not beyond the wit of man to actually arrive at a situation whereby the forward work plan is far more balanced in terms of the amount that we're expected to deal with at any one meeting? Thank you.
Councillor Edwards, I believe I've already answered the question in terms of realigning the forward work plan with the corporate strategy, and I do apologise that the volume of work has troubled your cognitive load. But we will do our best to try and smooth out.
With respect, sir, that's an insult, and I'm not going to bear to take that as well. That's nothing to do with my cognitive load. It is to do with the amount of papers we are expected in one meeting to consider. Okay. Now, if you want to be here all night, we can be here all night.
I feel we may be, because it's 8:45 and we haven't got past the forward work plan yet. Any questions, further questions on the forward work plan? Okay, thank you very much. Is that noted?
Noted.
Thank you. Item 9 on the adoption of the Town Centre Master Plan, found on pages 20 to 68 of the plan. Hello, an opportunity to find those papers. Councillor Hardwick, would you like to propose that?
Yes, I should propose this.
Do we have a seconder? Thank you very much, Councillor Swords. Councillor Harvey, would you like to take this paper?
Yes, all 48 pages of it. I think members have seen this in the past, and we've discussed it in the past. This is a supplementary planning document. It will become, once it's approved, a material consideration for the planning committee when considering applications in the town centre. So it is a very serious document. It also provides the framework for developers that are looking to submit applications for buildings in the town centre to work to. And even though it hasn't yet been adopted, some developers are already considering it. So I can pass over to my colleague Dan, because obviously Town Centre is regeneration. He's the cabinet member for regeneration.
This is a significant moment for the future of Harlow Town Centre.
because this evening we're passing the first of our three steps to delivering once in a generation rebuilding the town centre, promised for so long but not yet delivered. The master plan we will pass tonight changes the game. It means for the first time ever, we will have an element of control over the town centre and its development. A long-standing excuse that there are many landowners and therefore we can do nothing will dissipate with passing this new master plan. But we are not just giving the planning department material considerations for private applications. We are setting out our bold new plan to rebuild Harlow Town Centre. We are not rehashing the same old plans and initiatives that have lingered around the town centre like a bad smell for the past decade, fermenting in failure and lack of delivery. We're now setting out a one-way roadmap to regeneration. And I genuinely want you to imagine that in just 12 months' time, we will report to the same cabinet meeting that we have a fully designed new town centre with a fully mapped out programme of delivery, finance still secured and a development partner on board and further construction work underway. Because that is the future, not only that I confidently prophesize, but it's the future that this report sets out. In 12 months' time, we will be making good on our vision to make Harlow Town Centre one of the best in the country, with new clean green developments, cutting-edge design and delivering a new town centre with fine shops, bars, restaurants, cafes, and yes, live music. And I predict that there may be a question or two asked about this master plan. But I would say, to try and stem some of those questions, to those who I may call doomsters and doubters, who say that we've been here before, and perhaps less eloquently, to quote Councillor Durkin when this was announced last week, all this guy is doing is regenerating previous regeneration plans and pretending it's all new, and that it's evolution, not a revolution, or that only private developers will solve this. You have been wrong at just about every turn, and you are wrong again. So whilst you continue to criticise and come from the sidelines, we're getting on with the job. And I genuinely, eagerly await the response of the Labour Party to this, because obviously I've said I've mentioned once or twice in the past. They've done none of these things. They, you know, then try and claim credit for it, whilst at the same time criticising the plan, whilst at the same time suggesting cross-party support, whilst at the same time running around in circles trying to find the decision they stand to that. And I found that the last time this report happened, I think it was in October, the opposition so far stretched to find criticism that they supported it, or said they supported 95% of it. And then the day after, plastered the local media about how bad the plan was. So if I hear the words cross-party this evening, I may take them in a literal sense that the Labour Party are crossed in their whole time in office. They did not pass a planning framework. So ultimately, Chair, I am delighted to present this to Cabinet. And I'm pleased to say that in the same spirit, 1947, we are, with cutting-edge technology, industry-leading design, and the stewardship of the Gibbon principles, finally going to regenerate Harlow's Town Centre.
Thank you, Councillor Salt. Are there any questions on this paper?
It's not actually on this paper, but I was wondering, Adam, if I could have a set of papers, because I feel quite at a disadvantage, because I can't have my laptop open without having feedback. Would that be all right?
Welcome to our papers if you give them to France. So we've got sort of spare.
Well, I brought my laptop because I presumed I'd use that. I just don't want to cause inconvenience by having, and I just don't like having it open and causing feedback. So I've just, there's usually a set over there, so I'm just asking. If there isn't, it's just then as well, but. Use the set up back.
So we'll move to questions.
Thank you, Chair. I'm sure there'll be a debate in a few minutes, but I was just wondering from Michael, was he disappointed, or does he share my disappointment about the lack of engagement in the consultation process? Because certainly when you look at the groups that we do have, very diverse and very many in the town, that uses the town both for leisure, pleasure and business. Disappointing that only 20 odd of them made the choice to comment. All their comments are valued, to be perfectly honest, but would he share with me slight frustration that we didn't get more comments than we were expecting? Thank you.
Councillor Hartley.
As somebody who works in the business and getting people to respond to consultations in the day job, yes.
supplementary planning document, and I think I'm right in saying it's more responsive than we've had for any other supplementary planning document. And of course, in stage two and stage three, they've set out in the report, there will be much more consultation with the town centre. The final point I make about the lack of response to consultation is just that I was quite surprised when going through the responses to the consultation that Councillor Durkin, nor did the opposition respond to the consultation.
Do you have any further questions before I go to Councillor Lins? Councillor Lins.
Thank you, Chair. It's fair enough comment. Can I ask that Mr. Bramish did promise this would be in here, but can I ask that it's recorded on page 30 that there was a submission by the Harlow Epping Forest Cooperative Party as a neighbouring Cropton Party Council? I'd love that recorded. Thank you, Chair.
So duly noted. Any further questions? Okay, well, we move to comments.
Besides the vomitous comments that have been made by the current regeneration at person show just washes over, I have to say we've always been very consistent over this particular issue. This is, I know he hates it, this is about evolution. It's about moving the agenda on to the next stage. This was the next stage, and it doesn't matter if I'm sitting there or sitting where you're sitting. The situation would have been the same, and actually where we can agree, we should agree. When we disagree, we should disagree. But I'm really sad that you are allowing such nastiness to infiltrate this discussion. Sorry, you all right? Yeah, okay. I'm just disappointed that you've allowed yet again this negativity to go, which is nothing more than personal attacks. Fortunately, I'm old enough and wise enough to ignore silly comments, but I do want to welcome this report. I do want to work with the council, because together we can make the difference, because actually it's our investment and our legacy to this town to make that difference. So all the personal animosity, all the negativity, all the childish banter, one side. This is an important document, and we will welcome working with you if offered the opportunity to make it work. And certainly it will be something that we will take forward when we take power in May.
Thank you, Chair. I've been in politics a long time, and I know when and where not to make comments. And I think ultimately this is something that, you know, we would have done had we remained in power. I think it's an important document, and I'm glad that it's gone out to consultation. I think I share everyone in this chamber's disappointment at the lack of representation made in engaging in this. I think it was a criticism that, you know, you gave us when you were in opposition, but I think ultimately we all got to recognise that we've all got to do more to work to engage members of the community. And I know it's an agenda item later on. I look forward to more discussion and more scrutiny about the community engagement strategy, because clearly as a council and as councillors we need to do more to engage members of the community. David Carter. Okay, Chair. I would just like to say that over the past 3 or 4 years, when Councillor Eagle was a leader, I didn't so much in this chamber because of his bully boy tactics. I didn't like him. He was a nasty piece of work as far as I was concerned. So if Councillor Durkin thinks this. With all due respect, former Councillor Eagle isn't here to defend or rebut himself to pitch him. Please backtrack the remarks and focus on the current debate.
I'll backtrack that. But, you know, I've been at the other end of this, and I wasn't happy about anything. And, if we can all get on together and work to get these things sorted, that'd be much better. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any further comments from around the room? Councillor Edwards and Harvey.
We are comments?
Yeah. We are. I said Councillor Edwards and Harvey, but he's been a gentleman making way for you.
Yeah, no, I was just confirming that there was comments, not questions. I just wanted to make
and I think we have to all recognise that it's the opposite cause sitting beneath which parties in power that is really keeping these projects driving forward and maintaining consistency. And I just thought it was so exciting. And notwithstanding, we're likely going to a recession if we haven't already, and progress may be slow, I think it's a really exciting vision, direction of travel, and I think it's something that the council can be really proud of.
Councillor Edwards.
First of all, I just want to wish the council well for whatever administration in taking this forward. The second thing I want to say is that it is going to be a massive task. We're not in the situation that we were even 3 months ago. Economically, things have shifted enormously. So I would hope, in terms of going forward on this, that we don't get too carried away with hyperbole, that we actually say, well, this is a because I can remember the 2008 when Stockwell were involved, etc., and we then got the world economic crash that happened around about that time, and they withdrew. But up until then, there was a whole lot of expectation in terms of what's going to be happening with the town centre redevelopment, only for it to fall apart and then went into a lot of austerity. So given that we are in very strong, very poor economic times, with a whole lot of, who knows, in terms of the future, in terms of, in my view, a tsunami of economic stuff that's going to be coming our way. I just, whilst I wish this well, I just also hope that in terms of public expectation, that we actually take the public with us in terms of saying, this is what the process is going to be. It's going to be a long task and possibly potentially a difficult task to get us there, but we're all determined that that's what will happen.
Any further comments? I think before I hand over to Councillor Salt and the Councillor Harper for the final comment, I would like to say I too am excited by this. The prospect of town centre regeneration has hung over the town for a very, very long time. And when I was in the chair of regeneration, I was bringing forward those very ambitious plans, because it takes ambition and it takes drive to bring a project of this scale to fruition. And I'd like to commend publicly the ambition and the verve that has been brought to this very particular agenda by Councillor Swords, because it needs that in order to drive these sorts of things forward. It's not about hyperbole, it's about raising the bar and actually saying that we can do this. And whilst economic conditions can sometimes buffer a particular project, if we move cautiously and we do not move forward in a strong and purposeful way, then we will always be timid, and the outcome will always be timid. And so I make no apologies for the ambition that's set out in this document, and I'm glad to hear that the opposition are fully supportive of this, and I'm glad to hear that they were also planning to do this as well. I will, you know, be planning to buy a lottery ticket sometime in the future, and I plan for that to possibly win. And I say that just really to emphasise the fact that we can all say that we'll do things and we can all say it will come good, but actually, based on past form, it's unlikely to happen. So, without further ado, I'd like to move to final comments from Councillor Salt and to thank the Regeneration team at large for their technical support and indeed their ambition in bringing forward such a fantastic document. Councillor Salt.
I too will buy a lottery ticket next week, and I know I'm going to win it. But you are right in saying that it does take ambition, genuine ambition, to drive these things forward. It is, in my view, I think a poverty of low expectation if you don't have that ambition. And I always believe that if you
shooting for the stars and getting out in the atmosphere, it's far better than planning to walk to the end of the street and making it out your front door. And I think that implants what this does, but the wider point of this genuinely sets out a roadmap for the way forward. This is not, you know, this is not a pie in the sky document. There is a genuine roadmap that in 12 months' time we will have a design, we will have a development department, and construction work will be underway. And yes, it will be hard, it will be difficult, of course it will. We're talking about redevelopment of a town centre that's needed it for a very long time, and it hasn't been forthcoming. But I'm not a believer that the difficulty of a task should deter you from doing it at all. On the back of Councillor Harvey's comment, I totally agree in that the new combined regen and planning department have done an extraordinary job on this and on many other documents that we will read tonight and over the months ahead. And without them, none of these things would happen. I pay genuine and sincere tribute to each and every one of them in the role they've played in it. But now is no longer the time for plans and ambitions and pipe dreams and so on. It's the time for action, and it's the time to finally get on and actually do the thing. And that's exactly what this report sets out. And the final thing I would say on Councillor Edwards' point about hyperbole, I'm sure there are one or two people in this chamber that accuse me of hyperbolising every now and then. But I would say judge us on our actions and not our words. In 12 months' time, when you are still sat there questioning us about these things, you can judge us on our results then, as I judge you on the fact that in the 10 years you didn't write on these documents, and nor did any regeneration take place. So, I look forward to being out there with a hard hat on, and Councillor Durkin in tow, knocking down occasionally, how should we ever buy in the future?
That's an appointment.
Thank you, Chair. I don't think we are under any illusion of the complexity of this. You just have to look at the document that's before you tonight to understand what we're trying to achieve. But Councillor Sawes is right, it takes ambition, it will take determination, which will be over quite a long period. I mean, to get it going is one thing. It will take decades on paper for it to be completed. Thank you.
So with that in mind, can I see supporters if I move recommendations A, B and C all together? All those in favour? And none against, that's carried. Thank you very much. Okay, we move to item 10 for some more ambition. The new house building programme from ages 69 to 88. I look to Councillor Sawes to move that paper. Second of the paper. Thank you, Councillor Carter. Okay, Councillor Sawes.
Thank you, Chair. And forgive me for a slightly longer introduction than I would normally give, but I genuinely believe it's needed because I think everyone would agree this is a pretty significant document for the Council. I look forward to questions on it. The new House Building Programme is historic, not just because it's a wonderful read, but because it gets things done. It does a whole host of things to ensure that we deliver one of our key pledges to build hundreds of homes for our families. But not just to build white-coloured houses. This programme is radically different to perhaps the Pathfinder project programme or some others that have been delivered recently. Because this will deliver, in the round net zero, high-quality developments that put the given principles back into building in Harlow. I believe homes that people love with unique designs. And we will be building homes and neighbourhoods which I confidently again prophesize to my crystal ball that will win awards for design and architecture that people will be proud to live in and will buck the trend of net zero technologies and credentials. And this has been a long process to come to this point, I accept that. And process is the first point I want to address because there is genuinely no party political malice in this, but last March the Cabinet adopted at this meeting 12 months ago, adopted an independent report which exposed the failures of the then House Building Programme and said, to quote, progress has been slow than anticipated, There is not a clear governance arrangement, work between different departments was not drawn down. And this new house building programme addresses every single one of those points. The report sets out a completely new process for this council to build homes, a process that puts value for money, transparency and accountability at the heart. And again, this is not a party political point, but never again will this council spend hundreds of thousands of pounds of taxpayers' money on designs and consultants before discovering the water main under the site. And the fact that your own planning authority on some of the schemes would not have given planning permission for the designs that were put forward. Never again, in fact, will a scheme progress without accountability and transparency over who's made the decisions. I will be accountable, not just the Cabinet and the Scrutiny Committee, but to the public over the decisions that we take their money. And further to the Scrutiny Report, we carried out an internal review of the Pathfinder project and the scheme that I know the opposition quite rightly and never tire us of telling that they initiated in Bushy Croft. And this threw up some fundamental failures that perhaps when I point out to the opposition they may downplay their claims. First, having passed the climate emergency declaration in 2019, their scheme designed in 2020 boasts very little net zero credentials. It does not have solar panels. It did not, until actually the legal council visited the site, have any electric charging points planned. I'm pleased to say that will be installed. The properties themselves are not fitted with net zero technologies, meaning that those moving in will still have to pay substantial energy bills, and at a point they will have to then be retrofitted those homes, costing more money than perhaps a bit better planning had taken place wouldn't have had to been spent. The Scrutiny Committee in March 2021 set out 20 wide-ranging recommendations on internal processes. Our internal review threw out further recommendation, and this new programme gets those things done. It addresses all of those points. And I turn now to the credentials of the new programme. And I want to stress it is a new programme. And I perhaps here will stem some of the questions that are to come, particularly about phase one, because there are no schemes in this report which are the same schemes that we were left with when we came in last May. In fact, I've already highlighted a few weeks ago that 1.13 million was spent by someone on projects that never happened. And that brings me to the first point of the new programme, which is value for money, because we will deliver absolute value for money at every stage of this process, not just because we have a duty not to waste taxpayers' money, but because the more value for money we provide, the more homes we can build. We promise not to waste taxpayers' money, and I believe this programme will get that done. In terms of funding models, there are some trusty age-old models of funding council house building, and we will exploit those. But we cannot be bound solely by those methods. While so many pockets of our town have been neglected and left for those reasons, it is the case that some of these pockets will not stack up in terms of using those funding models. And if we were to take the approach that has been taken, those pockets of land just are left there. That's why we're putting shared ownership on the table for these limited situations. By doing so, we help residents get on the property ladder and we regenerate the area. We're also going to relook at, as the report sets out, Section 106 policy to bolster the war chest for council developments. In terms of net zero, all of our schemes aim to be net zero, and this is not just important to meet the remarkable ambitions I think were set out in the climate change position statement, but because those tenants moving in will pay next to no energy bills in those properties. And I must apologise actually, because there is an error in this report, which I take no shame in pointing out, and that's in talking about building costs of net zero, where we projected it'd be 5-10% higher. But in that fantastic tax cutting spring statement from the Chancellor yesterday, he announced that he would zero rate those products, and therefore the cost of our council house building programme has just plummeted. And we promised to tackle climate change and build a town fit for the future, and I believe this programme will get that done. And in terms of policy and design and build, swathes of estates across the town were built using cutting-edge technology and unique design, as per the specification of the Newtown Act. Whether it be the Northbrook flat roof or the Mediterranean atmosphere of Bishopsfield, we promised high-quality homes for Harlow families, and again, I believe this programme will get that done. And, I know some of the jobs that will come, but I grew up in a council house, and I am seriously passionate that council housing is not second tier. There is no reason that council housing should be built at a bog standard quality with the cheapest materials. There is absolutely no reason for that, and we will not do that. This programme, as I said, will deliver industry leading homes with similar examples already highlighted in the report. And the final thing I want to cover is the difference between phase one and phase two, which I am sure has caused some confusion. This report will now be an annual report to Cabinet, and this time next year, as I've said, I'm absolutely confident that all of the phase one schemes will be under construction. I think the fact this is becoming an annual report not just shows the significance we are placing on it, but that it allows proper accountability at every single step of this process. But there will be no more dither and delay. Phase two is far more expansive, actually, than the annex sets out, and the true nature of what phase two will evolve into, I think, will be far, far wider reaching. And I heard a comment this week on the grapevine that one person said this is a jam tomorrow programme, and I respectfully say to you, you cannot be more wrong, because phase one sees not one of those schemes which were left by the previous administration. Therefore, I entirely refute this idea that all we're doing is copying Labour's schemes, again, a complete mistruth. The only thing that remains the same is the land now identifies for phase one schemes, and if they wish to claim credit for pointing to land on map, I suppose they discovered Australia too. And the final thing I would say is this is a programme that I think we can be genuinely proud of. Because the Conservatives are delivering hundreds of new council homes for Harlow families of the highest quality and in the right places.
Thank you, Councillor Saltz. An inspirational introduction to what is a very ambitious programme indeed. Are there any questions from anyone? Councillor Durkin.
Chair, we'll come on to the debate about the cluster and the comments, but we'll put those to one side. I'm pleased to see all the projects on the pipeline that were instigated several years ago are coming on to fruition. I was just wondering if I could just ask a couple of questions, if I may, specifically on, I think it's Appendix 1, it's all the ones that have been agreed. Will you confirm that full feasibility studies have been completed for all those that appear in the blue section of your report? And also, can you just briefly explain, because I know Elm Hatch has always been a huge challenge because of its closeness to the church and the pond. And I know several applications in the past have been turned down for the size of the roof was one of the particular issues from English Heritage. Could you just explain what the 12 dwellings will be at Elm Hatch? I'm also now assuming that the Stapletye depot, which was going to be used for small businesses, is now being converted into housing. For me, the personal disappointment of not being able to build that landmark building at Lister House because unfortunately somebody forgot to check where the tap was on that particular issue over those ones. In relation to the Yorks, the original plan that we put in was actually for single floor dwellings rather than two-storey. Is that still the ambition, because it would blend very nicely into the area that we've got. And then I'd like to come on to some others later on, if I may, Chair.
Just to correct the point which I did make, I think perhaps the pre-prepared drivel could have been put in the shredder, as we did with the pipeline. Because, as I said, none of the schemes that you left us with are the same schemes that we are in front of us tonight. It may go over your head, as I'm sure did that 1.13 million taxpayers' money spent on schemes that didn't happen. In terms of the details about individual schemes, as the report sets out, of course, all schemes will come back to Cabinet for approval at the appropriate time, and of course there will be due accountability and transparency on each stage of the process. You asked about Elm Hatch, and I think and covered quite eloquently one of the issues that was long standing in that you were putting forward schemes that were being turned down by your own planning department, and as such was a serious issue. I'm not going to speculate now what that will look exactly like at Elm Hatch, because I think there is enough speculation about things at Elm Hatch at the moment. And as I've said, that's, you know, there's nothing covert about that. The scheme will come back to Cabinet at the appropriate time when it's ready to be approved. The feasibility study you asked about for phase one, the short answer is yes. I believe that Annex B, I think it is, actually sets out the stage at which each of those schemes are. In terms of state tire depot, the ambition, again, I won't go into too much detail because it will come back to Cabinet in the fullness of detail, but it's for a mixed-use scheme. In terms of the listed house site, there's a couple of reasons, obviously, that didn't progress. One being that there was a water main under the site, and there remained a water main under the site, and as such, the scheme that you'd designed and of course about £450,000 on wasn't feasible to be built. You mentioned that someone didn't check there was a tap. I may politely suggest that at the name at the top of every Cabinet report is relevant portfolio holder's name, whose responsibility it is to be accountable for such these actions, so I wouldn't try and pass the buck on that. The other thing I'd say about the listed house site is it was described as too expensive, too difficult, and management nightmare by experts on the matter, and as such, didn't progress. On the Yorks, I may again respectfully point out that you are wrong, and this is a running theme, but the scheme that you approved in December 2020 was not for single-storey units, it was for double-storey units. One of the first things that Councillor Carter and I done was, as I said, put that in the shredder, and if I don't believe we were able to attend the December Cabinet meeting of December 2021, but if you look at the Cabinet reports from December 2021, you will see the fact it sets out very clearly that the double-storey scheme that was set there was scrapped to be replaced with a single-storey scheme. So again, I may respectfully point out that you were wrong on what you were doing, and we have set out to the public exactly why we're doing that. I think that covers all the questions, but if it doesn't, I'm happy to answer.
Thank you, Councillor.
Out of the, I won't get into a debate with the Cabinet member because it's 20 minutes ago, and I think it's fairly pointless. I think we come from opposite sides. Out of the, you've indicated that a number of these schemes that you would be building and will be completed in the next 12 months. In light of the fact that it says that some of them are feasibility stage, some are site feasibility just being undertaken, pre-app advice received and pre-app received and full planning, which ones of these are you confident that you will be cutting the ribbon on in 12 months' time?
If I politely point out paragraph 46 of the report, it states all phase one schemes which you're referring to are planned to be at stage three of the new house building programme within the 2022-2023 financial year. This means all schemes in phase one will be on site under construction in 2022-2023 or in early 2023-2024. It in nowhere in this report does it state that those schemes will be finished in that financial year. It can take longer than 1 year to build these things. So again, I'll make politely point out you may have just misquoted that, and in answer to probably your wider point, I'm absolutely confident we'll be on site under construction on all of those phase one schemes.
Thank you for that reassurance.
Any further questions? Councillor Raven, it's a question.
So, a commitment as far as the 99 is concerned that they will all be council houses, and since council has it, i.e., paying council house rates, etc. Yeah? And then there is a debate to be had in terms of the other sites going forward as to what the tenure mix will be. Are you able to give any sort of undertaking that where those sites are currently council housing, i.e. people are paying council housing rents, that they will that there will be a balance going forward to ensure that we don't lose any houses which are, we don't lose the balance of council houses to other tenures going forward over the, you know, over the next few years. So for example, if, I don't know the figures here, but supposing we've got 2,000 council houses on these sites at the moment, and they're all council houses, if you're saying going forward there will be a mix of tenure going forward, will there still be an aim going forward to ensure that when we come out the other end, that the very least we've got is 2,000 council houses, i.e. paying council house rents, developed as well as other.
Thank you, Councillor.
Just one clarification I want to ask, and then I'll answer the wider point. You're saying about what's there already, you're not closing, knocking anything down. We're talking about building new homes, so there's not.
But some of the hatchets, for example, we're looking to redevelop the hatchets at the moment. Some of those may well be council, especially council houses, council paying council.
Oh, I see what you mean. Yeah. In terms of tenure type, again, the report sort of said came in paragraph 12 and moving on to paragraph 13 and indeed 14. Everything in phase one, obviously, is social rent, as you would know it. And as the report sets out, we'll be looking to do what this administration done, push across in terms of Homes England funding to ensure they are truly social rent and not affordable rent as was planned. In my opening remarks, I've set out my passion to build council housing at social rent. And where that is financially viable to do so, we will do so. What we're talking about is in areas, for instance, where in terms of social rent to council housing, it does not stack up in terms of value for money. At that point, you present an option. You either do nothing or don't build to council housing. If you do nothing, you leave the area as it is. So what I'm saying is, rather than leaving the area as it is, we will look at shared ownership, which is far more likely to stack up in terms of value for money. We can actually deliver the schemes and we can get people on the property ladder at a much better rate than they may otherwise be able to do so. But if the wider assurance you're talking about are you know, the vast majority of these schemes going to be social rent, yes, is the answer to that. What we're talking about with the shared ownership is more in the situation where, and this may not be, you know, in every case, each site will be taken on its merits, but rather than doing nothing, I would much rather deliver a scheme of shared ownership and get people on the property ladder than do nothing on the site.
Do you have any further questions, Councillor Evans?
Just a comment from that book, thanks for the reassurance. Yes, I wanted to phrase it badly, but what I wanted to ensure that as we go forward, we don't arrive at a situation where at the end of it, yes, we might have new housing, but the proportion of council, what we traditionally known as council housing, actually decreases. Because at the moment, one of the things that's happened as far as across the town is concerned, we've gradually seen council housing disappear, as if, either through the right to buy or
thank you. Just one question. Will you look to sell parcels of land that are perhaps too complex to develop for the council to do so economically viable? Would you sell that parcel of land to private development?
On the whole, that's the issue we're aiming to address with the look at different tenure types, because in my view, if we were looking to sell them, I'm not suggesting we are, but if we were looking to sell them, we would probably get more money for them if we built a brand new home on them than the land itself, and therefore it would be much more financially viable to build it than sell it. challenges in here, or in Annex B or C, of areas that we believe we would fall into that situation with. But again, my point of it is there are difficult sites across the town, and in my view, and others may disagree, you essentially have two choices at that point. Well, you give me a third, but you have two choices at that point of either doing nothing or developing it. And if it doesn't stack up for, you know, social rent, council housing, as you know, then we would look to the shared ownership model. In I believe, you know, 99% of cases, then it would stack up financially. But, you know, now we're getting serious hypothetical. If it didn't stack up, then we may look to build to sell. But that's, you know, it's not something the report sets out, because we're, you know, pretty confident in all of these schemes it will be social rent in a very small proportion shared ownership.
I think it's an exciting opportunity potentially to give them the opportunity to build their own homes on a parcel of land. And we've got such a robust framework of building and development that, you know, I think we're confident people would build, you know, extremely nice homes. And, you know, it would just seem to me that it, even a shared ownership scheme on some of these really complex sites, you know, it is more than possible. It is actually likely that it will be not financially viable for the council to do it, but the revenue you could make from the sale of the land could support other schemes. It's not a question, sorry.
Are there any questions on the report? So we move to comments. Councillor Dirk.
Yes, thank you. You know, I mean, it would be very childish not to disagree with something that we had already put in place and in train at that particular time. The regeneration, cabinet member, is actually correct. The original plan for the Yorks was a mixture of flats and two bedroom houses, as that was required by the housing team at that time. But actually, this is one of the things that you said was wasted money, is that we carried out a survey and we carried out good consultation with the local residents, and that's why it was pulled, that we didn't think it was feasible, achievable, or what the wider community wanted. Clearly, they always come with costs, but it's actually better to get it right as early as you possibly can. In relation to the second listing, which starts at Riddings Lane and goes down past Slattsbury Hatch, everyone, it's also my understanding that the principle is that you've got to speculate to regenerate. And again, you'll notice that the consultant's budget is there. Some of them have been approved and some haven't. But this is where everybody's claiming we wasted all this money. This was where this money was used to have consultation to assure that we were doing the right thing for the right reasons at the right time. It's not just a man and a stick going onto a piece of land and saying, yeah, you can build it. The regulations are immense. The regulations, I'm sure the officers will compare, can be a nightmare to actually go through over these particular issues. I just also wanted to pick up the point that the cabinet member said, and I actually don't disagree with it, Aim, on one particular issue. We'll probably disagree on the time of day, but it's actually about shared partnership and it's about sharing responsibilities. And certainly we've got a strong history of this council for doing that, and I can only refer you to Clifton Hatch, which is a superb venture with new shop, new outlets, and about 30 to 40 housing association buildings that was actually built on council property and was linked directly to the council's waiting list. And of course the one which used to be formerly known as the Three Hills, where we've actually got 200 to 300 dwellings that was actually on council land, council property, but we actually went into partnership with one and got a win-win. So we've got plenty of evidence of success stories. I know, I understand you want to rewrite history. You just want to say everything that we did was bad, was wicked, was willful, but actually the truth is it wasn't. But legacy will show that that wasn't the case. And actually, the good people of Carlow know the difference between fact and fiction. We've got to give them a level of intelligence. But I welcome the regeneration team for everything they do. They really do the very best they possibly can for the benefit of the town. So absolutely, let's get on. And I hope, even though I wasn't invited to the briefing over this particular issue, I do hope I will be invited to come along when whoever it is, or it may even be myself, will cut the ribbon on all new council houses for Harlow. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor. I'm aware, Councillor, that you'd like to speak, but we have come to 9:30, and so it's obligatory of me to ask councillors whether you'd like to continue and whether you would like a short comfort break. So I'll ask on the first, would you like to continue?
Yeah.
Would you like a short comfort break?
Yeah.
Yeah. It will be a short one, particularly for the room. Just a reminder, we'll be back at 2:55, so we can continue. So be quick.
And with the 2050 net zero target nationally, we do know that any homes that are built now that aren't net zero ready will need retrofitting, potentially considerable expense. And so much of being an efficient council, one of our key aims, does depend on this kind of long-term thinking, so that Harlow taxpayers of the future, and indeed social housing tenants, can benefit from this full planning. And it's also really encouraging to see that the report looks at the best practice examples that already are out there in other parts of the country, but I do feel that Harlow needs to aspire to be the example that people look to learn about net zero house building here, especially within social housing. So I do think this report sets us very much on the right path towards that, and I just wanted to commend councillors also for his leadership on this. Thanks, sir.
Councillor Durbin. You've already made comments.
I know, but it's just a very quick comment. And what I want to do is join up the dots, because I do welcome, and also I'm hoping that the building of these houses will be HTS when the new company is set up.
Further comments? Councillor Edwards.
I do welcome, as Chair of Scrutiny, I do welcome some of the way that the comments that were made by the Scrutiny Committee in terms of processing, etc., have been picked up a lot and now being evidence. I would just like to remind members, if I may, as a comment, that it was a cross-party committee, and at the time the Labour administration were actually in the majority on that committee, and we were committed, as I hope you will be going forward, to looking at processes within the council where processes could be improved, that that they should be picked up on and followed through. And I now hope that one, as and when this meeting this gets approval, I suspect it will, that I then hope that at long last, perhaps the politicisation of scrutiny committee reports can actually come to an end. Thank you.
Aspects, particularly around the environment, and looking at different models to get people onto the housing ladder to make use of land where there are complex issues arising from that. And it is an ambitious programme. Just wanted to pick up on a couple of things around scrutiny. Yes, we welcome scrutiny, and any politicisation of scrutiny, I've been aware of under this administration, because we've given the opposition the chair, the scrutiny, which is very high and proper, and they do have naturally the right to scrutinise us on that, and they continue to do so. So any politicisation of that, I don't recognise at all. Without further ado, unless they are, I'm going to leave the line share to Councillor Swords to wrap up.
Yeah, thanks. I won't speak for too long, but I'll just cover some of the points that have been made. These are in no particular order other than the outside I scribbled down throughout. This is the only mildly political point I would make. I said for the third time that none of the schemes in phase one are the schemes that we were left with. As I said, all of those have gone through the shredder, so again, to suggest that what we're doing is following your lead, or perhaps rewriting history, as you say, again, is a mistruth. Anyway, that's politics side. I genuinely thank the scrutiny committee for the work that was done on the report, because I think it has, as this report sets out, it seriously focused minds and has led to drastic action. I also want to thank Councillor Carter, because I know for many, many years, and this is with no prejudice to anyone else, I don't believe there is anyone in this town that's championed the cause of building council houses more than yourself. And I don't believe this report will be here tonight. In fact, I know this report will be here tonight if it had not been for the work you have done and the passion you've shown. Perhaps you are the first invitee to some of these openings of the schemes. And the final thanks, again, is a genuine and sincere one, which I will exacerbate behind closed doors, but there was a chap sat behind me, and I'm sure that's not the proper way in which to say this, but who has spent many, many, many hours, along with an incredible team, making this happen. And I know that thanks to the work that they've done in recent months, there will be hundreds of families in this town over the next few years living in high quality housing, and I don't think anyone should underestimate just how much work the officers have done on this, and that includes the housing officers as well as planning. And yes, to address your point, James, if you look at the three-stage process, finances has its place firmly in there. A couple of other things very quickly to cover. I said there was no other political points, but I couldn't let the one about fact versus fiction miss. You're absolutely right. People probably do know the difference between fact versus fiction, and that perhaps is why in such great numbers they elected the Conservative last May to build council homes, and that's what we'll do, and I'm sure they will do so again in a few weeks. And the very final point to make is about something the chair has just covered, about the enthusiasm and ambition, because again, I'm sure at times I stray into hyperbolising, but this is genuinely ambitious, and I think you should have a great amount of enthusiasm about it, because quite often we do things in this chamber that don't really affect people's lives and don't really make a difference to their lives. This is one thing that I think will make a drastic difference to thousands of people. Not just across Harlow, but as Councillor Dunn referenced, Harlow will be the showcase for building council homes, and I think it will inspire thousands, millions, hopefully more, to be built across the country. So I think this is a good day for Harlow.
Thank you. With that being said, I'd like to move recommendations A through to E. Can I see all those in favour? None against, that's carried. Thank you very much, everyone. Right, now moving on to item 11, use of compulsory purchase orders to advance the development of Harlow and Kilston Garden Town, found on page 89 to 299 of the panel. I'm going to look to Councillor Hardware to move that, please.
I second.
Thank you. Do we have a second item? Thank you, Councillor
Salt. Councillor
Harlow.
Thank you, Chair. The council using CPO panels is a very serious thing. The principle of using CPO panels, which was announced to Garden Town, was agreed by Cabinet back in 2020, and it was with cross-party support. The Two River Crossings, to which this CPO relates, has now secured full planning permission by both ourselves and East Hearts. The river crossings were negotiated and agreed by the previous administration, which is
it's rather strange that they actually voted against it when it came to planning only a few months ago. The development of new housing at Gilston, which this CPO enables, is one that has been long supported by Highland Council as a development that will support the renewal of the town. Most of the land in Harlow that is required for river crossings is in fact owned by the local authorities and other statutory bodies, ourselves, Essex County, Network Rail, Homes England, and the Canal and Rivers Trust. Clearly, the CPO order is a measure of last resort, and every step is being taken to undertake to acquire the land through negotiation. Any costs that are incurred by this council as a result of making a CPO will be met by the developers of Places for People through an indemnity agreement which they have signed with us. Officers are confident that discussions have progressed with all the landowners for the Harlow land parcels and are likely to be acquired through negotiation, but we still have to have CPO powers in the background just in case. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Hardaway. Any questions on this document? Okay, I'll move to comments. Therefore, I ask if we move. Oh, we have comments all of a sudden. Yeah, great. Councillor Lynn, it's fine.
Just very quickly, Councillor Hardaway's comments. What the last administration people have recognised the need for a second crossing should 10,000 homes be built on the other side of the bridge above the store. It even agreed the best location, it didn't agree the detail, and that was for the planning committee. It may be felt that some people feel that the planning committee has no teeth on this matter, but I think that's a subject for the government to give more power to planning committees if that's the case.
Just because, as you said, this is, Councillor Harper said, this is no small matter and a very important issue, and I just wanted to remember that I satisfy myself after having a conversation with Andrew Bramage that, as you say, it is extremely unlikely that this will be necessary to amend. One hopes that's the case because it would be a pretty bloody process, I imagine, if it does come to that. It's a positive step. Hopefully it never requires to be enacted, but recognise the significance of it, and I think it's excellent. And it shows progress. So thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Hartwood, some overseas. Thank you very much indeed. Okay. So I'm looking that we move recommendations A through to D. All those in favour? Fantastic. Okay, so now we come to item 12, the community engagement strategy. Found on pages 300 to 322 of the bundle. I look to Councillor Joel Charles to move in favour.
Report, Chair.
And what is your second? Councillor Tan. Councillor Charles.
Thank you, Jenny. Community engagement strategy is a defining moment for the Council to embark on broadcasting, which too often in local government is a habit of local authorities, but to enter into an open two-way conversation with all the communities that make up our great town. From the outset of taking on the community resilience element of my brief, the focus has been with officers to move this forward at pace. We're now in a position to present this strategy to Cabinet. One of the core elements that drives this strategy is a focus on the fact that sometimes residents feel frustrated about how local government engages with them. And this strategy aims to change that. You'll see in the strategy that there are a range of topics that we've set out initially for the council to engage with the public. They include areas like state renewable. We've heard all about the exciting plans around housing, economic growth, key as we come out of the COVID pandemic, and also community safety. What I've tried to do with this strategy alongside the work with officers is marshal them around five outcomes and an enabling objective. The five outcomes are designed to empower residents and those individual communities, and you will see in the strategy how we've articulated that. It's backed up by the fact, within the enabling objective, that this council is setting in motion a robust KPI to ensure that each department has to have a responsibility for engaging with residents in this town and take that forward seriously with a performance indicator that pushes them to get on with that focus. And we're doing that within this strategy. So I'm pleased to see that, and was pleased that S&B moved that forward so that we can now benchmark our performance against that. This is about positive action. It's an exciting roadmap, I feel, to take engagement to the next stage with our residents. But we're also going further in the way that we present our documents to the public. We have a range of communities, diverse communities, that sometimes need different types of aids to be able to communicate. And so this council will be embarking on a wider suite of aids to support people to engage, feel that they are included in these processes, and I'm proud of that. I know that my colleague Councillor Simon McCarter has championed this, and it is now reflected in this strategy. So I look forward to Chair to seeing questions and comments from members.
Thank you, Councillor Charles. It's very good. Questions? Councillor Edwards.
The talk about KPIs, I just want to. Has there been any work done so far on those KPIs and what those KPIs will look like?
Thanks, Chair. Subject to agreement of this community engagement strategy, I'm going to check that it is agreed. The exact wording of that performance indicator will be agreed, subject to the 6-week consultation period.
Any further questions? Councillor Harvey.
I just wondered if you could say what will be different for the people of Harbour as a consequence of this this report. What will manifestly be different for to experience the engagement of the council?
First of all, we have committed to changing the different types of materials that are given to different groups that focus on visual aids, different aids for people, disabled people, those people with learning disability. We will embark on, it's a clunky term for it, but easy read documents. I don't like the term myself, but that is the conventional term for it. Putting that to one side, however, what you'll see in the strategy is we have set out a range of topics that we want to consult on. There will be the regular suite of consultation activities, whether they are whether we decide to do road shows, whether we need to do digital engagement, whether we look at how we communicate with what is our ageing population. We need to understand that. Part of the consultation is that we don't have all the answers. We want to bring the community in as part of that 6-week consultation to bring in their own suggestions about how we reach our diverse community. So it will be, as I was doing today, talking to the voluntary sector about different elements of this. And if they've got ideas that they want from me, the council will of course look at that. And I invite councillors as well to participate in that consultation because I want to get the right tactics to enforce this strategy. This is the vision. We've got to focus next on the delivery plan for this.
Is it possible or likely that you might increase the council's capacity in terms of staff to match your ambition?
Not that I would prejudge any funding analysis that my learned colleague Councillor Lampard would advocate. But what I would say to you is we are clearly looking to resource our community engagement. Those decisions though are subject to the usual budget rounds, I'm afraid, Councillor Harvey.
Councillor, I'm waiting for you, but just to connect, actually, I think it would be a comment. But any further questions for Councillor Charles? Okay, we'll move into comment then. Any comments on the strategy document?
Firstly, can I say how much I welcome this? I think it's, I've spoken to the officers and I very much welcome the approach it's taken. I also welcome the fact that there's going to be KPIs that are developed and they're going to be developed across all departments as far as I'm aware. One comment. I think I really liked the statement on page 318 where it says we will strive to develop and embed a new inclusive engagement approach to ensure that we can actively engage people in groups that may be viewed as hard to reach or vulnerable through age or disability, for example. We will try to ensure that everyone, regardless of background or circumstances, has the opportunity to share their views. Now that's quite a profound statement, a statement of intent, so I welcome the statement of intent. I think that in terms of going forward, I think that statement in terms of age or disability needs to be included more to the front of the document, because that's what you're seeking to achieve. You know, so I think that would bear in mind, that would also take into account the council's responsibilities under the Equality Act 2010 and enable us to push that to the fore. So I hope you take that in a constructive way that it's meant, because I think that could strengthen the document and can strengthen the consultation period.
Thank you, Chair. It's always amazing to me when I agree with Councillor Edwards. Councillor Charles has already mentioned my comments about this. Primarily reaching those who are perhaps handicapped in some way, can't engage. One of the other specific issues is actually recognising that not everybody in the town is IT connected. There was a survey about 2 years ago that identified about 70% of our residents are not actually IT connected. They're thrown into sharp focus by the lockdown and trying to move to teaching at home. The fact that not everybody is actually needs to be built in, and so certainly support Councillor Edwards about highlighting accessibility by the hard to reach groups and so forth.
Any further comments? Councillor Edwards.
This is not specifically on this or this particular paper, but I think it's been very heartening tonight to see our claim, which we set out in the medium-term strategy, to bring about a more efficient council. And one of the things we mentioned, paid some stress to, was the importance of different portfolios working together. And tonight we're seeing this with the housing, with environment, with finance. We're seeing it now with Councillor Charles's ambition to bring this about. Of this policy implemented across all the portfolios, I think we should all be quite proud of it. We are now putting into practice our claim to make a more efficient council. Thank you.
Just very briefly, I have a interest on how work for charity that supports unpaid carers, and just thought it was then worth mentioning, and particularly young carers. I think they're a hard to reach group, often forgotten because they don't assume a disability themselves. They will find it harder to engage, so just want to mention that.
I just wanted to make a comment. This line on page 318, We will try to ensure that everyone, regardless of background or circumstances, has the same opportunity to share their views, let us know what their needs are, contribute to identifying community solutions to local problems, and participate in co-production processes where possible. I'm going to have to leave this meeting in about 5 minutes, and obviously I'm the opposition, and that's not of any real consequence to anybody, but I've enjoyed the session, and I would like to be here for the rest of it. But I don't have childcare in 20 minutes' time. My babysitter stayed an extra hour. And as one of the two women participating in tonight's session, I just want to really say to you all, you need to work harder to get more of us in here.
Yeah.
And a long meeting like this, and I accept your absolute right to have an ambitious program and push things through. But it was very difficult for me to read the papers fully, which I always do and I did do, in the time we had between when they're published and tonight, but I managed it. And I'm disappointed not to be able to stay for the full session. And I just really want to say that your intention starts in this chamber, and we can talk about people being on the margins and think it's people who are disabled or who have all sorts of really difficult challenges to face, but women, mothers, you know, it is really hard to participate to the full extent in local community the way you're able to, and I just want to make that comment. And I accept that Councillor Charles will absolutely hear me when I say that, because I know that he is sincere in his intention.
Thank you. I'm going to say a few words and then hand over to Councillor Charles. The sentiments expressed in this paper are, and I fully agree with what Councillor Charles said, this is part of the administration actually working as more efficient council, actually reaching out, trying to engage with the community. We're learning by engaging with the community and bringing people with us, of whatever political colour or persuasion, to be seen to enfranchise everybody and make them feel like they've got a stake in society. And that's better for everybody in the long run, if everybody feels they have skin in the game. So the point that Councillor Hart has just previously raised, she's quite right, it is particularly difficult, and getting more women elected into public office is particularly challenging. And I have been on, would you believe it or not, that Women to Win march in London, and I was there with Sandy Tosby, pushing the man to get more women into elected office. So I fully understand what she says, and I also sympathise with the childcare issues that faces her. I will just preface that though by saying that it's not just a strain that women only feel, even though she's quite right to point it out. I'm a father of two children myself, and I have to find cover, I'm still saying like a teacher, but still have to find somebody to help look after them as well. And I wouldn't have been there tonight, and I wouldn't have been there all week either. And I suppose that is part of the problem of being in political life in general. And it is a great strain, and there will be all of us in here who have similar strains. But I do hear what you're saying. And when we can try to balance things out, we will, but sometimes it is just almost impossible to avoid. And we do have an ambitious program, and there will be people out there that are in equally difficult, if not worse, situations. They're looking to us to try and make their lives better and to improve things for them, and they expect us to get on and do that. Sometimes that does require a great deal of personal sacrifice, which I recognise, Councillor Harvey. I see it in many members in this chamber of both genders.
As the woman who just spoke up, all you had to say was, I hear you. You didn't have to pontificate for 6 minutes afterwards. With respect, just say, I hear you.
With all due respect, Councillor Harvey, I'm supporting what you're saying, and I have the right to...
On your terms. Just accept it. On your terms, just say.
I think that's really distasteful what you've just done.
I think it's distasteful to say what you said to Tony. Thank you.
say it. I recognise the sacrifice that everybody here makes, and we will try our best to try and accommodate all those individual sacrifices that we make, which is when we come back around full circle with the beginning of the forward work plan, we will be looking at that and trying to even things out. So without further ado, over to Councillor Charles to sum up.
Thank you, Chair. I think the opposition have raised some fair challenge tonight. I'm grateful for Councillor Edwards and Councillor Harvey for framing the points that they did. What I would say is the purpose of this strategy is to ensure that local government is more accessible. And that's the framework that we have set out with the five outcomes and the enabling objective is to do that. I think this is an exciting opportunity to deliver a bit of co-creation between the council and a range of communities so that we can enhance the decision-making process in this civic centre. And for that reason, I look forward to this being approved so that we can get on to the real work. That is engaging with people, not just talking about our vision, but actually getting out there and support. And that ultimately is what we're all elected here to do, irrespective of our political colour.
Thank you. So, all those in favour of recommendations A and B on page 300 of the board? So, Carrie, thank you very much indeed. Moving on to item 13. Adoption of open space supplementary planning document on pages 323 to 428 of the pack. I'll give you a chance to find that. Councillor,
I so move.
Thank you, Joyce. Here's a second. Thank you, Councillor Saltz.
Thank you. Apologies again, another 100 pages for you to wade through. This has come before us before. It was approved by Cabinet last year and subsequently gone out to consultation. A bit of a challenge to get too much response to this, what is a very technical paper. We had a handful of responses from the right parties, I might add. We made several very small amendments, and which is in the report.
Any questions on the report? Any comments? Okay, I'll move straight to the vote then. So if I see those all in favour of recommendations A and B, thank you very much. Right then, item 14, a walk of partnership grants, page 429 to 438 of the panel. Councillor Charles, would you like to move that? So move. Thank you, Councillor Burkhardt. Councillor Charles.
Thank you, Chair. The allocation of grant aid to voluntary sector organisations is an important milestone for the voluntary sector in particular. It was great actually to address the voluntary sector forum today. One of the core aspects before we got to the allocation of these grants was consultation. And we held, for example, a consultation event with charitable and voluntary charitable organisations in the town, and we set out with them in partnership the criteria that the new partnership grants which will be allocated are defined around. So, for example, the three key elements of the wider criteria are one, to improve social inclusion and reduce inequality, to tackle financial, food, and digital insecurity and debt, but also improve opportunities for employment, training, and skills development. So those were some of the examples of the criteria. What then happened was an exercise that officers undertook to engage with the organisations across the town that may be eligible for foreign aid support, criteria sent out. Those organisations then submitted their applications based on that framework that the council had designed. And as a result of that, what the council has done and set out in the paper before you is banding around the award of these grants. I would just highlight that this is £130,000 that would have a direct impact to the town's charitable organisation.
because they are the backbone of our local community. Regrettably, it was overly subscribed, and so it was a very difficult task for officers to go through what was an excellent array of bids as a result of the advertisement of this council and the engagement that had taken place. We've got the bandings there, and so what will now happen going forward is, of course, the council's intention is to inform those organisations that go through to the next stage. There is in the report an indication of the payment mechanism that will be applied as a result of the bandings. But Chair, I do welcome questions and comments from councillors. Any questions? Councillor Evans?
So I suppose my question is, do we as a council need to be looking? I mean, if those bids have been submitted are, I don't want to use the word worthy, can't think of another word at this time or not, but if they're the sort of bids that we should as a council be supporting, I suppose my question is do we actually need to look at this that figure, that £130,000 figure, with a view to increasing it at some point in the future?
Thank you. What I would say, Council, is we are not the only vehicle in the town where there can be support for these types of initiatives. As it happens, at the voluntary sector floor today, a representative from the Harlow Health Centres Trust was there to talk about the work they're doing to deploy a significant amount of money to address health and wellbeing issues in the town. So what we need to do as a council is it's not just organisations that want to deploy other things that will complement what we're trying to do with the voluntary charitable sector and deploy that money even more across the town so that we can deliver that direct impact. That is something that we will consider. The other element of this, as you will probably know, the government will intend to, in the late spring, as ministers have announced, the full prospectus guidance on UK shared prosperity fund. Now, why that is significant to Harlow is that as part of then there will be a discussion where certain districts chair, we now move forward with engaging with those organisations that have gone through to the next stage.
Thank you very much indeed. All those in favour of recommendation A on page 429 of the report? Thank you very much. Okay then, item 15, fire safety works, Normal Town 1 to 28 and 27 to 56, and Storch Tower. It's on page 439 to 441 of the report. Councillor Carter.
Thank you, Jeff. I think it's been made fairly clear that this evening a priority of ensuring safety tends to make members in all of it is, whether it's a house or a high rise. These two buildings, obviously, Griffin Terms and Hawk Tower, are high rise buildings. And it's primarily for fire safety works. But it's very important to stress that none of our high-rise buildings are at risk. None of them have any suspect planning. But obviously what we need to do is to ensure that the buildings are as safe as possible. Now, this has the updated fire compartmentation between the floors. What we have been doing is replacing the air systems, which have left ducts and the ventilation system. So we need to make sure they are all securely sealed, but also taking care of the sort of doors and fire doors. Again, there is the liaison with the retailers in particular, it's a good thing. It's another 1.3 million that we are having to pay for out of the housing revenue account. Because it doesn't have any of the risky elements to them, there's no government money or subsidy available for it.
Questions for Councillor Carter? Comments? Councillor.
Thank you, obviously I very much welcome this report, as I've always welcomed over many years now since I had the fortunate service to Greenfield, the importance of fire safety. Now I know it's the 9%, as well as Councillor Carter, we're quite lucky in Milo that we don't have any tower blocks that have that kind of failing to put our residents at risk. And I just welcome the report, the continuation now, which has gone on for several, probably about 3 or 4 years now, in making sure that all our tower blocks are coherent and safe for all our residents. I've certainly welcomed this report.
Okay, any further comments? Okay, okay, so I'll move to recommendation A on page 439. All those in favour? Thank you. To item 17, operational buildings, FM contract award, page 445 to 447. Councillor Lampard, do you move? Yes. Seconders? Thank you, Councillor Swords. Councillor Lampard.
Thank you, Chair. This relates to a facilities management contract with HDS. For maintenance and mechanical boilers, electrical works carried out at the Civic Centre and that's in Bush Centre. The contract that they have at the moment is due to expire on the 30th of June, and there's some quite urgent work required to be undertaken at Latin Bush regarding the repair or the replacement of the boiler. I initially wanted to see this, as with most other things, to go out to tender. However, I've been assured by officers that the facilities management team that HDS has been specifically contracted from outside the company. They now work in HDS and are performing very satisfactorily. The amount involved is 85,000 over 3 years, which is the proposed extension date of their existing contract. And having spoken with them and seen the market testing they've done and their recommendations as to the competence, specifically the facilities management team, I move that we go forward with this proposal.
Thank you, Councillor Lepman. Are there any questions on the paper? Comments? Okay, there'll be nothing more novel.
No.
My chair will move recommendations A and B on page 445. All those in favour? Thank you. Any against? Okay, let's go. Thank you. Moving on to item 18, HDS Property Environment Limited Contracts Award for 2022-23, on pages 448 of the bundle. Councillor Carter, could you read that?
That's the move, Chair.
Seconded up. Thank you, James. Okay. Councillor Carter.
Thank you, Chair. There are five items appearing on the agenda. It's got an award with four separate contracts, but it's actually only one item. It's part of an annual round of a couple of works that HDS has bid for under the value for money proposals. It's all pretty much repairs and maintenance. It's routine stuff. It's what HDS do. They do it as well. And I thoroughly recommend it.
Questions for Councillor Carter? Comments?
Just to welcome investment into stable time.
Very good. Okay, Councillor Carter, can you give one player before I go to the vote? Please don't abuse my generosity at this time.
I won't put Councillor Gunn's comment. This has affected the properties all the way across the town, so I'm sure we've been there. Apart from, of course, my own ward, Church on the Trust. I won't go to that.
Thank you very much. Okay, are we content to take recommendation A on page 448? Item 19, North Essex Parking Partnership Agreement, page 469 to 474. Councillor Gunn.
Thank you, Chair. And
can you move
that? I do move this.
I see a second. Thank you, Councillor Hardware. Councillor Gunn.
Thanks, I'll keep this brief because I know we're getting very late. I hope the Impala's membership of the North Essex Parking Partnership has proven successful over the past decade. This agreement is a commercial item. Your agent has turned around the situation deficits in consistent surpluses, which are used to support road safety improvements in Impala and other partner districts, and will also be used by Essex County Council to support strategic highway projects, such as the installation of EV charge points. I would briefly wish to draw attention to the fact that just last week that agreed to freeze the cost of residents' first parking permits through 2023 and in practice until summer 2024, and to keep residents' parking permits higher significantly cheaper than in any other part of the district. This will be welcome news to vehicle owners worried about the cost of living, which, alongside our record of council tax cuts, has proved positive that we're on the side of all the residents.
Thank you, Councillor Gunn. Any questions on the report? Comments? Before I hand back to Councillor Gunn, I would just like to re-emphasise that thank him for his work on this and for taking into account the cost of living, holding permits and making sure that the prices are frozen into the future. And I welcome his comments on council tax. Thank you very much. much. Can I move to the vote on recommendation A on page 469? All those in favour? Thank you, that's agreed unanimously. Okay, now moving on to communications from committees, working groups, parties and panels. We have a referral on page 475 of the pack from the Cabinet Policy Development Working Group. Councillor Swords, there's a recommendation here that we need to adopt, so can I see that you move that, please? Can I see a second? No.
Sure.
Okay, thank you, Councillor Carter. Because it's a referral from another committee, I'm just going to move straight to see if there are any questions on it. None so much. Councillor Swords, do you feel there's anything you need to say on this before we go to the vote?
It's a fantastic document, I'm pleased.
Thank you very much. Can I move to the vote then, and that we move recommendation out to page 475. Thank you very much indeed. Then we've got the referral from the Cabinet Policy Development Working Group, the Climate Change Position Statement on page 592 of the pack. And move to the Council down just to move that. Second, please. Thank you, Councillor Harper. Again, students refer to move straight to questions if there are any. Any comments?
Sorry, mate.
Councillor Dunn, do you have any comments you should make on this?
Not particularly. Yeah, beyond just wanting to make the Cabinet Policy Development Working Group and particularly check Chairman Johnson, because of course Sally's standing down there, and to thank her for Chairman of that group for presenting this
group. And as we move into the vote, I'd also make that sentiment and thank Chairman for her work. moving to recommendation A and B on page 512 of the report. Do I see all those in favour? Thank you very much. None against. Okay. We have minutes of panels and working groups. We've got the minutes of meeting Tuesday 15th, 22 of the COVID-19 recovery working group on page 608, 615 of the back. They are for noting. Are they noted? So, thank you very much. Before I finally sum up, on item 22. You had a question on item 22.
No, you covered.
So they were noted. Do you have a question?
I do have a question.
Could I really ask you to put that in writing to the chair of the committee at this late stage? Is that possible, Councillor Edwards? Because we've noted the items.
Yeah. Well, very, very quickly, and then I will follow up.
Basically, the figures that we were given then related to the last COVID working party. I looked at the figures for tonight, and it's noticeable that the numbers in Harlow are going up again. We have between the 18th of March and 24th of March, 753 people confirmed positive tests, and the numbers are going up in hospital. Now organised people in hospital, which was 157% increase over the previous 7 days. So I think we just need to be aware of that. And my question is the COVID recovery panel was closed down. It was brought to an abrupt halt without any cross-party discussion. My hope would be that given that these figures are now starting to increase again, some cross-party discussion about how we're going to be monitoring things and looking at COVID.
Thank you. And before I go to item 22, if I've caused any offence to Councillor Harvey, it was not intentional, and through you, Councillor Vince, would you pass on my apologies, sir, and I will write a note when I reflect on what was said. Because to be fair, I'm tired and I'd like to have a think about what I said. Okay, I've been not notified of any matters of urgent business, so that being that, at 11:25, I close the meeting.